vestibule, etc., etc. Now, let's go on to the more serious. As I told you, now the fun part is over. We are becoming more and more serious. Liver. We always talk about the liver as a plate of cells arranged side to side. So much so that on either sides, right and left, is the sinusoids, and the liver cells are attached end to end. This is where curiosity in higher light microscopy pushes me to understand, to look for certain important cell junctions, or rather modification of cell junctions. Now, 1, 2, 3, and 4 I have identified, but among them, I am going to show you only one, because the lower two are a little, you know, I will give room for a little doubt, but the upper two are classic, and that is the bile canaliculus seen in light microscopy. Now, the first thing I have done is, you saw the difference, I will repeat again, this was the HND. I have increased the contrast and reduce the color. You see, most of the histology slides are overstained to the extent that they come in the way of details. Therefore, I have used digital technology, reduce the color, that means the saturation has been reduced, the contrast has been enhanced, and now that dot in the center of the two cell membranes joined together is becoming visible. Now you see, I give a blow up of that huge blow up, and you see marked by the yellow arrow, you can see the two cell membranes are plastered together, but right in the middle, there is no plastering, there is a small canaliculus. The lining of the canaliculus is the cell membrane of the two adjacent hepatocytes. Therefore, this is a beautiful example of a bile canaliculus. Yet another example, bile canaliculus. Next, duodenum. Conventionally, in a duodenum, the signature feature that we talk of is the Brunner's glands. And we say identify and give two reasons. The spot flash write up or the answer will be, sir, long villi, finger like villi, and the Brunner's glands. Okay, I agree, that's the correct answer, and you should deserve a distinction for the identification. However, very interestingly, between the muscle layers, you know, the circular and longitudinal layers, you will see a cluster of neurons. They are the parasympathetic ganglia, and we know they are the Auerbach's plexus. Very, very commonly seen in even the best, in even the most excess stained in hematoxylin biosin, but we routinely ignore it as another cell type. But when you look for it and you pinpoint it, it becomes obvious. We know that parasympathetic ganglia are located close to their organ of innervation, or many times within the organ itself. Now, this is a classic example. Large intestine. I don't have much to talk except the lamina propria. When you compare it with the duodenum, there will be a beautiful beginning of the lymphatic channel. But in the case of the large intestine, there won't be such a channel. This is my one of my best slide collections, and probably the last, because I am sure Dr. Balaji is waiting with the bell. My 40 minutes time is getting over. Let's finish with the retina. You see, this is how we generally put an eyeball slide, focus on the retina, and that's it. But then, if I ask what is here, we say, oh, rods and cones, sir, because there is a pigmented epithelium right above it. That's all. But when I use a special stain, again, I repeat, this is a Kertesz stain. If you notice carefully, the staining characteristic of this stain, this is a solitary stain. That means it doesn't have double contrast, single contrast. It gives you an excellent ivory yellow versus dark brown contrast. For the first time in such a huge blow, I am able to see at least some cells which are definitely cones, maybe certain other cells which are probably rods. Next, you see, I kept a rod and a cone next to each other. Okay, one is a rod, the other is a cone. If you're not convinced, yet another demo. You can see here, in the same slide, there is a rod and a cone. This is a rod, and the one next to it is a cone. So with a little bit of effort, that's what I'm trying to say, with a little bit of effort, if you can try to catch the uncatchable detail, your understanding of the subject will be improved. Now, Balaji sir, the time that was allotted to me is up. I would like to say thank you to every one of you and take leave of you all. Vanakkam. But if there is time and if the chairperson would like to permit, I can take one or two queries or left to the chairperson. I would like to spend 10 minutes talking exclusively to the faculty on some of the techniques related to histology presentation, whichever way, provided time is there.
Sure, sir. Aarti, can we continue?
Sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir,
you can go ahead, sir. We have time.
We have time, sir.
Then you will assure me that you will yes, stop George, me.
Assurance is given, sir.
Thank you, sir. Now, lungs. You see, this is a classic thing which we tell must know for all the students. You must be able to catch one continuous, a field where everything can be seen, you know. A little of the bronchiole, a little of the terminal bronchiole, a little of the respiratory bronchiole, alveolar sac. And this is a classic slide. Every student would have mugged it up and they will draw beautifully in the exam. There's no doubt about it. But then, can we try to understand it a little more better? Well, we also know that this is a respiratory bronchiole. I'm not going into the details. But what I want you to catch is, in the, we always very easily identify the cuboidal cells with cilia. That's quite easy. But we try to, you know, ignore or oversee or just, you know, bypass the non-ciliated cells. But when you carefully examine among the many, many ciliated cuboidal cells, you may find here and there one or two, but then you have to really, really look for it. You may find non-ciliated cuboidal cells. If you find it, treat guaranteed that you have identified a Clara cell. Now, type 1 pneumonocyte, okay, it's a routine thing, well seen in virtually every single alveolar septum. I'm not talking about it, but what I would like to talk is type 2 cell. Type 2 cells are more globular, more, you know, roundish, and they project very, very prominently into the lumen. That is why that is important. Of course, I don't have to repeat. It's a surfactant secreting cell. Next, in addition, in the same septa, alveolar septa, you can see in the cytoplasm, there will be a lot of dirt particles. Okay, except in the newborn, everybody else, particularly in cities like Bangalore and Chennai, we will have abundant these particles. So it's obvious that these are the macrophages. Next, kidney. Routinely, I'm not going to tell you kidney, glomerulus, nephron, no. I believe you know it. The problem is, can I challenge you to the horizon? Can we go to the horizon and see what we normally think cannot be seen in light microscopy? Remember, that is the objective of today's lecture. Let's see what we can see. Now, you see. Now, podocyte is something that is there in every single glomerular design. But think we really don't pinpoint. You say most all the cells are after all podocyte. No, but then there is a specific identifying feature of a podocyte. The podocytes, like I showed you in the previous slides, always bulges out like an umbrella in the visceral layer of the Bowman's capsule. That is how you identify a podocyte. Next, PCT, easy to identify, long cells. lumen is comparatively small for the length of the cell. Shown in yellow arrow is its counterpart, the DCT, where the lumen size is large when compared to the cell height. Okay, nothing in particular. In other words, we are heading towards juxtaglomerular apparatus. Again, it's beyond my time limits to give you the fine details, but I will make an effort to show you whatever additionally I can show you without confusion in this. Now, see, efferent arteriole can be seen on one side. Its counterpart shown in yellow on the other side is afferent arteriole. Now, that area, suddenly there is an increase in the cell density, is the macula densa. The word macula densa, the word densa itself tells you there is a higher aggregation of cells, smaller cells. Now, that is a macula densa, probably osmoreceptor in function. I don't know much about it, but your physiologist must have given you a detailed review. Now, this is the extraglomerular mesangial triangle, mesangial cells. Now, you see, these cells, you can see particularly in this mesangium, the lasis cell or the extraglomerular mesangial cells. Now, these are the juxtaglomerular cells, modified smooth muscle cells. That is very, very typical. In fact, the word myoepithelioid is used because it is nothing but some smooth muscle cells which have been modified for a particular regulatory function. Uterus, another interesting slide. There are a lot of things that we routinely miss. Myometrium particularly, thick muscular layer, three-layered, etc. But then, in the muscular layer, there is a stratum vasculae. Plenty of cross-sections of the blood vessels are visible. Now, we'll talk about those vessels. These are the vessels that routinely we call it as arcuate arteries because they go all around the uterus. They have a circumnavigating the outer muscular layer of the uterus. But then, from there, radial branches are given off into the deeper areas, into the endometrium. Now, those are rarely seen because we routinely treat it as some blood vessels. Now, you see, lower down here is the muscle layer, and you can actually see penetrating through the muscle layer, going into it as in a radial fashion, into the endometrium or the radial branches. This is very good demo. Now, when you go towards more and more towards the surface, and as the uterus moves over into the advancing stages of the secretory epithelium, I'm sure the spiral arteries will begin to dominate. Now, the spiral arteries end in, instead of routine capillaries, which we talk of in every other organ, brain or duodenum or stomach, wherever, here in the uterus, particularly in that upper areas of the endometrium, they end in small pools, you know, small lakes, with, of course, endothelium, no doubt, but it's not as small as a capillary. It is much, much larger. You can call it as a sinusoid, maybe, but then it is bigger than a sinusoid. So the word lacuna, endothelium lined lacunae, may probably be a better option. Now you see, here is an arcuate artery in cross section. Then you can see there are two lumps of muscle tissue, smooth muscle, and you can see actually a radial artery penetrating into the endometrium.